In this video, I'm going to talk through the lessons that I learned from racing probably the toughest Ironman 70.3 on the circuit. I'm going to talk about how I'm going to take these things that I've learned, implement them into my training, and be the best I can possibly be for my next race day. And fingers crossed, along the way, give you guys loads of tips and tricks to go away with so that you can be the best you can possibly be for your next race day. For those of you new here, my name's Harry Palmer. I'm a British professional triathlete, and this channel is all about documenting my journey in the pro ranks, but also looking to educate, entertain, and inspire other people to get involved in the sport. So if that sounds like something you'd be interested in, please do consider hitting the subscribe button down below. It helps the channel out massively. So without any further ado, let's crack on with the video. I need better open water skills. For those of you that don't know, I came out a minute behind the front pack and I was kind of leading the chase pack. And I don't think that was down to swim fitness and overall fitness, because in the pool, I've been putting out some really, really good times. And this is something that has happened, a similar thing has happened last year when my first race of the season was Mallorca 70.3. And I kind of tanked the swim a little bit and just had a really poor race. From then on, I got better and better and better, not because my swim times were getting better in the pool, my fitness was getting better. It was more because I was becoming a better open water swimmer, learning how to position myself, learning not to blow up in the first couple of hundred meters, and all of these different things. So I need more open water practice. Of course, this is the first race of the season, so you're always gonna be slightly rusty. I actually take a lot of confidence from this, because I was only a minute behind some of the best swimmers in the sport. My fitness is there, I just need better swim practice. So I'm gonna get in the open water once the water warms up a little bit. I'm not getting in it right now. The other thing is to position yourself well on the start line. Now, I feel like I did this quite well because I positioned myself close to Andy Horsfall-Turner, who's arguably the best swimmer in the sport, Josh Lewis, who again, one of the best swimmers in the sport, Rhys Barkley, who's a bloody good swimmer. And so I positioned myself really well. So from there, I had a really good opportunity and I just sort of messed it up with poor open water skills, sitting on feet, sitting on hips, and essentially just expending a bit too much energy too early on. And the whole idea with the swim is to be as fast as possible for as little energy as possible. And that's something that I'm really gonna work on. And I would say to everyone watching this video, open water swimming is such a different ball game to pool swimming, and it is really, really worth getting confident in the open water, swimming with other people that are perhaps better than you in the open water, making yourself uncomfortable, because in race situation, it is uncomfortable. You're gonna feel like you're in a washing machine, you're gonna have people slapping you. You know, I had someone grab my shoulder and push me down in the water. If you can get used to this in training, in racing, you just brush it off and you continue with your race. And that's really, really important. The next thing I learned is that I need a bit more practice in my TT position. Lanza was a very difficult race in that it's pretty much an hour and a half up draggy hills in TT position, and then half an hour downhill towards the finish. So a lot of time is spent in position. There's a lot of pressure on you to get as aerodynamic as possible. And I feel like my position does need a slight bit of work. It looks really good on the turbo, it feels really good on the turbo, but out on the road, I need a bit more practice. Now, ultimately, that's how I'm going to get better in my position. On the turbo, it's fantastic, but it's a controlled environment. Outside is where you're gonna be racing. That's where you're gonna be battling the elements. So, fingers crossed, the UK weather gets a bit better and I can ride my TT bike outside. And that's something I would stress to all of you watching this. Don't just focus on your position on the turbo and save racing outside or riding your TT bike outside until race day. Get out on your TT bike, get out in position, feel what it's like out on the road, and make it as aero-optimized as possible while also being as sustainable and as comfortable as possible. I'm also in discussion with a company about making
some sort of extension plate to push this cockpit further forward. The footage in Lanza showed that I was quite cramped on the bike, and although I felt like I could push good power, I feel like there's big improvements to my TT position that I needed. And so, fingers crossed, this extension plate is really going to solve a lot of those problems.
My fueling strategy and execution of that strategy was pretty good, but it does need a little bit of work. Essentially, on the bike, I took two of these litre bottles with me, one behind the saddle and one between the bars. What I took with me was good, however, the distribution of that wasn't so good and does need a little bit of work, a little bit of trial and error. I also mentioned in my fueling strategy pre-race that I was going to stop at an aid station to take on more fluid. So I am going to make use of the aid stations. And because I was in such a race mode to try and catch the group in front, I completely forgot and I bottled it. So towards the end of the race on the run, I did feel slightly dehydrated, and actually having more fluid on board would have helped a lot. However, on the bike, when it comes to carbs, I managed to consume 110 grams an hour, which for me is really good, and I felt really good for that. However, of course, because I went too hard on the bike, I still ended up suffering. Now, when I talk about the distribution of my nutrition needs work, what I mean by that is the saddle I had behind the seat? The bottle I had behind the seat was all my electrolytes. The bottle that I had between my bars was all my carbs. This, on a normal course that's fairly rolling, when you're in a group as well and you've got opportunities to sit up, it's not a problem. I actually find it a really nice way of having things that are separate, because I can keep an eye on both of those different things, and it just helps a little bit with GI issues when you keep things separate. However, in Lanzarote, because I came out of the swim slightly back, I was in no man's land, I was on my own, I was battling the elements, I didn't have a group around me, I wanted to stay aero for as long as I possibly could. The issue is, my electrolytes were behind my saddle. So to get to my electrolytes, I had to sit up. And that means that I'm going to be less aerodynamic and I'm going to be slowing myself down. So if I thought about it more, for a course like that, what I should have done is distributed the carbs and electrolytes within each bottle so that I could address the bottle between the bars first, empty that, either chuck the bottle at an aid station and move the bottle from behind my saddle to my bars, or just sit up and swap the bottles around. That means just one sit up and then you've got the bottle right where you need it, instead of having to sit up multiple times to grab your electrolytes. Due to putting carbs and electrolytes in the same bottle, it can cause a little bit of GI distress, so I'm going to be really focusing on this in training and trying to get my body as adaptable to that as possible, because a course like Lanzarote really, really suited that, to make sure that you can stay in aero position. However, if there's a course where I can get away with sitting up a little bit more often, I wouldn't mind having my electrolytes and my carbs separate. However, I think it's really important to be adaptable and to make sure that you are focusing on making sure that your setup and your fueling strategy works for each individual race. And for Lanzarote, my strategy just wasn't quite right. Not being afraid to make decisions is really, really important. And I'll tell you what, even though my decision to fully attack on the bike and try and catch that group in front, even though it didn't pay off, I'm really, really happy that I did make that decision, because it showed me where that limit is. It's given me confidence in my decision making. And I'll tell you what, like, if I was to do the race again tomorrow, I'd probably make that same decision. However, I'd hope that I was better out of the swim, so I didn't have such a deficit to catch up, so I actually could have caught up. However, you know, if that decision paid off, and if that move paid off and I did catch the group, I guarantee I would have finished in a far better position, and I'd probably be sat here making this video saying, yeah, I'm the best decision maker in the world. Yeah, I absolutely smashed it, and I took a gamble and it paid off. Unfortunately, that's not the case. The gamble didn't pay off. But I think it's really important, like, don't be afraid to make decisions. I made a big decision, I made a big call, it didn't pay off, but that gives you information for next time. That gives you experience. It gives you confidence for that next decision that you're gonna make. And I think if you don't make these gambles on race day, and sometimes these big decisions, you'll never know where that limit is. You'll never know if that gamble could have paid off. And I think all of these decision-making, confidence, presence, all of this stuff, it all comes from experience in racing. And so for me, I'm actually going to try and race quite a bit this year, purely because every time I race, it gives me more data. It gives me more information on what worked, what didn't work, what did I do well, what didn't I do well, how can I be better for next time, so that my next race is even more positive. And every single race, there are going to be good things and bad things, but the more you can race, the more information you can get from that, the more confidence you can have in your decision-making process. But not shying away from those decisions early on, I think it's really important. So I hope you guys have enjoyed that video. Just gives you a little bit of an insight into my analysis of my race day at Lanzarote and how I'm going to improve for my next race. Fingers crossed you guys got some good tips from that. Let me know what you thought of the video in the comment section below. And like I mentioned, please do consider hitting that subscribe button. It helps out massively. Now, on to the next race. I'll be totally honest, I don't know which one it is. I've got some decision making to do. Let me know what you'd like to see me race in the comment section below. I've got some ideas, but I'm open to suggestions. I hope all your training is going well, and I'll see you guys in the next video.